Genesis chapter 7. So this chapter is basically the continuation of what started in chapter 6. So remember that the chapter breaks and titles are not actually in the original text. The Hebrew Bible didn't have chapters and verses and things like that. It was just the one continual scroll. These breaks were added in later for the sake of convenience, but I think it's really best to read chapters 6 and 7 all in one bite, and probably the whole story to get the whole thing. However, in the last chapter we saw some weird things with the sons of God and the daughters of man, but the biggest thing that we learn is that mankind has completely fallen short of God's call in their lives, and they've fully rebelled against his covenant. And God, in this situation, would be justified in just wiping everybody out. And yet, he chooses to spare the life of Noah, and consequently Noah's family, and he starts a new creation with his family, kind of like a new Adam and Eve. And so in chapter 7, verse 1 through 5, then the Lord said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and all your household, for I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. Take with you 7 pairs of clean animals, the male and its mate, the pair of animals that are not clean, the male and its mate, 7 pairs of the birds of the heaven," and he goes on to talk about the animals, clean and unclean, that he's supposed to bring. And then at the end here, he said in verse 4, he says, "For in 7 days I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and every living thing that I have made I will blot out from the face of the ground." And so God sends Noah into the ark, and even though he goes in, he still has to wait 7 days for the rain to actually start. So they just kind of have to camp out inside of the ark for a week. And so notice here the repetitive use of the number 7. Now 7 to the Hebrews was the number of completion. And so this belief comes from the creation narrative, of course, in which the act of creation and God resting when it was done at its completion took 7 days. And so 7 represents God and the perfect number of God, but it also represents completion, because God in himself is perfect completion. And so if God tells Noah to bring 7 pairs of clean animals, it signifies that the number he is telling Noah to bring is the perfect, complete amount. And now, we're not really sure at this point what clean and unclean animals would have meant to Noah. It's not until we get to the book of Leviticus that we get a list of animals that were clean and unclean for the Hebrews. And these animals seem to be in addition to the pairs of all animals that God commands Noah to load up on the ark in chapter 6, verse 19. So he's got all of the animals, but then he's got 2 pairs of each of these clean sets of animals. Now the clean animals will serve a certain purpose because they're animals that Noah can sacrifice later on. But I believe it's interesting to note that this implies that there were also unclean animals probably on the boat, both clean and unclean. And so the Israelites hearing this story would probably puzzle at why God would bother to save these unclean animals. But as we saw in the previous chapter, God is interested in a total restoration, not just of the clean, but of the unclean as well. And for more proof of this, wait till we get to Acts chapter 10. And so in verse 4, we see a bit of a reversal from the creation narrative, even though it will eventually lead to a new creation. But in 7 days, instead of completing creation, God will wipe it out. And God will wipe the slate clean and start again with Noah and Noah's family. And now verse 5 is also an important thing to note here. "And Noah did all that the Lord had commanded him." Now, this is an important message, obviously, to us nowadays, but also very much so to the original hearers, because the author is very specifically showing that Noah did all that God commanded him to do. And had he not done that, it's likely that he too would have perished in the flood. But the keeping of God's commandments is what blessed Noah with life, just like the giving of God's law in the wilderness gave life to the Israelites as they were headed to the promised land. And so chapter 7, verses 6 through 10 is kind of a recap, kind of summarizes the introduction to the flood. It almost seems as if verse 5 wraps up the first section, including chapter 6. And then verse 6 in chapter 7 is kind of an introduction to part 2, which is the arrival of the flood. So in chapter 6 through 7, verse 5, we kind of have this buildup of the coming of the flood. And then in verse 6, we have the beginning of the next section, which is the arrival of the flood. And so remember again, because the author reminds us too, that we're looking at a full week before this event occurs after Noah goes into the ark. And so in verses 11 through 15, the flood finally arrives. And so Noah in this section and his family and the animals, they all gather into the ark. And what we see here is that the Lord is the one who shuts them in. And we see that in verse 16. And those that entered, male and female of all flesh, went in as God had commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. And so this is kind of an interesting thing that we see here. Noah is the one that did the work of building the boat, and Noah did act in obedience. But in the end, that would have meant nothing if it wasn't for God sealing him into the ark. All right, so all of the work that Noah did was an act of obedience, but none of that would have meant anything if God had not actively sealed the ark. So even though Noah played a part, which was obedience to God's command, he still had to fully rely on God to make sure that they were fully safe, which I think kind of speaks to our own good deeds. We are required to obey God and act out in obedience and listen to what he commands us, but our obedience to God ultimately is not what saves us. Our decision to follow after Christ is not what saves us. God is the one who saves us. Lest we ever think that it's our good deeds or even our decision to give our lives to Christ. God doesn't want us to believe that that's what actually saves us. What saves us is God. He allows us to participate in obedience, and he draws us to him to a point where we make the decision to follow after him. However, God is the one that does the saving. All right. Even just that little part of sealing the ark, if that hadn't happened, the waters probably would have filled up the ark and Noah and his family and the animals probably would have sunk to the bottom and drowned. And so even though they're obedient, God is the one that they still need to rely on for salvation. And so in chapter 7, verses 17 through 24, we see the flood finally occurs. Chapter 7, verse 17 says, "The flood continued 40 days on the earth. The waters increased and bore up the ark, and it rose high above the earth." All right, it occurred over 40 days. Now, the number 40 is also significant in Hebrew literature, and it appears at least 146 times in the Bible, this number 40. And so because it's so important and so symbolic, I think oftentimes when we see it, it's kind of a hint. It could, I think sometimes the authors maybe round up or down when a number is close to 40 and put the number 40. Now, again, they're not trying to be liars. And maybe it could be that God, you know, specifically made things last 40 years or 40 days on purpose. But what we see here is that the flood lasts for 40 days. And now 40 years was generally the amount of time between generations. All right. The fact that Noah and his family were in the ark for 40 days is kind of a shortened version of that, but it shows again that this is an act of recreation. God is starting something new. When Noah and his family get off of this ark, it will be like a new generation, a new beginning. Right? And 40 was the amount of years that Moses was raised in Egypt. 40 was also the amount of years that Moses was in the wilderness as a shepherd before the Exodus. 40 was the amount of years that the Israelites wandered in the Sinai wilderness. 40 is the amount of days that Jesus fasted when he was tempted in the wilderness. And so the completion of a 40-day and or a year period signifies the beginning of something new and something fresh, a new creation. And so we have another interesting phrase here in chapter 7, verse 18, where it says, "The waters prevailed and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the face of the waters." Now, where have we heard this phrase, "face of the waters," before? We saw it in the very opening of this book, in the creation narrative, in Genesis 1, verse 2, where the Spirit of God hovers over the face of the waters right before he brings purpose and meaning in creation. All right, and so this again signifies that we're getting a recreation story. God, again, is transforming the chaotic, scary waters of the flood, much like the formless and void, watery state of the earth prior to creation, and he's transforming it into something new, something useful, something meaningful, something beautiful. And what a lesson this teaches us about hard times in our lives. Now, this was a very dark time for Noah and the earth. This was a time of pain and of loss. However, we must understand that God's ways are not our own. Some people think that this punishment was too severe for the evil people of the earth. But what is so contradictory is people, or sometimes the same people, will complain about God allowing evil things to happen to good people, and how can it be that, you know, you serve a good God if bad things happen to good people, and why doesn't he do something about this evil? But then when he does do something about that evil, we accuse him of being cruel and unjust. It's not fair that you did that to them, God. I mean, it's almost like a lose-lose situation for God in the minds of calloused unbelievers. But God is bringing justice after the disobedience of people made in his image. But he doesn't just stop at that justice. This justice is not the end. He will bring new life and new creation, and he will bring a place of hope for the righteous through this dark time. They just need to trust in God, just like we need to trust in God during dark times and allow him to seal us in during these hard times and trust that he is the one that is in control. And so the flood comes, and it's a very dark time. And in verse 20 of chapter 7, it says that the highest mountain was covered. The waters prevailed above the mountains, covering them 15 cubits deep. All right, so the highest mountain in the world was covered by at least 15 cubits of water. That means, again, that if this was global, Mount Everest would not just be covered, but it would be underneath over 22 extra feet of water, putting the top of the water just below the stratosphere. And so again, the author was likely unaware of Mount Everest, and it was likely what they're saying over the tops of the highest mountains that they knew of, which in the Near East, the highest quote-unquote mountains in that area are little more than what we folks from Montana would just call hills. All right, I live on the big island of Hawaii where we have Mauna Kea, which towers 13,000 feet above sea level. Now that's a mountain, all right? That mountain gets a lot of snow, and it's one of the tallest mountains in the United States. Now that's a mountain, all right? And so what is likely happening is the author, in his context, in his world, is saying that the highest mountain, which is more of a hill, in his area was covered by water. And for more information on the whole idea of a global flood versus a localized flood, you can check out the verse-by-verse teaching of Genesis chapter 6. But in 7 verses 21 and 22, it says, "And all flesh died that moved on the earth, birds, livestock, beasts, all swarming creatures that swarm on the earth, and all mankind, everything on the dry land in whose nostrils was the breath of life died." All right, all the living things on the earth or land died. Verse 22 says that everything with the breath of life, and that breath of life comes from God. God is the one that grants us life. And as Job reminds us, God can take it away. And when God chooses to take a life, he is simply taking back what he has given out. God is the one that has the final say on the amount of time that a person lives. And so going back to this question about, was this too cruel of a punishment? I mean, to think that God is more cruel for taking a life during this flood than he is when he takes the life of a 100-year-old man who dies peacefully in his sleep, I think is to not understand the character of God. God is the giver, the sustainer, and ultimately the taker of life. Now, what some people ask is, does that mean if somebody is murdered, God is the one that murders them? No, God is not the one that pulls the trigger. However, God is not shocked by this. God knows that things like that will happen, and sometimes God does not put a stop to that because sometimes God is wanting to take that person home, whoever it is. If it's a believer, God allows these things to happen and he takes that life back and takes that person to be eternally with him. And then in 7 verse 24, it wraps it all up by just saying that the waters prevailed on the earth 150 days. All right, and if this is confusing, what the prophecy was is that it would rain for 40 days and 40 nights. And when it says the waters prevail for 150 days, it just means total with the rain and the amount of time that the earth was under this flood was 150 days. All right, so about 5 months. And so what do we learn from Genesis chapter 7? First of all, what we see is that God has a plan for the redemption of all life, us and the rest of his creation. We see that a lot in the story of Noah. We also see that obeying God brings blessings, but ultimately, our security is in his hands, and it is not, thank God, dependent on how well we obey him. We also see that God sometimes brings hard times into our lives, and these hard times cause us to rely on him. We also see that God is just in his punishment. In his justice, we can see God's mercy being shown towards the righteous. And maybe not right away, but we can see it eventually. And what we also see is that God is the giver, the sustainer, and ultimately the taker of all life. And so that is Genesis chapter 7.